Our next speaker is Dr. Michael White, the Conservation Science Director at the Tejon Ranch Conservancy. He will discuss how the Conservancy oversees the restoration and active use as a working ranch for more than 240,000 biologically diverse acres, harboring more than 60 at-risk species. Please join me welcoming Dr. Michael White.
Thank you, Steve. So when Denise first asked me to present at this workshop, I was, I think I was among the people that perhaps William Jordan was speaking to. I don't consider myself to be a restoration ecologist. And in fact, my immediate sort of, you know, flashback to restoration is when I was first starting out in consulting, and this is what our restoration group did, was create wetlands largely for Clean Water Act compliance types of activities. But, you know, what I've learned over my career is that, you know, we have an array of different landscape types that provide different conservation opportunities. So you can go from urban parks and green belts to suburban and exurban kind of reserve systems, large working, private and public working landscapes, all the way up to very large intact wildlands. And that these different landscape types have different characteristics that affect biodiversity. And so, and it's also an important, you know, I'll maybe stumble around and talk about biodiversity, but there are a lot of other conservation values that we care about as well. And I think Christy did a good job of touching on those. And so we think of what we need to think about is, you know, my mindset is ecosystem management. And sometimes we're trying to restore to something. Other times we're trying to, you know, affect an outcome in some way. So the other thing that Denise had asked us to talk about were constraints to ecological restoration, and specifically, are they technical, institutional, financial, psychological? I would add philosophical. I kind of equate the two. And of course, the answer is yes. They are all of these things in different settings and different situations. And so I just wanted to give, before I jump into all the Tejon stuff that I've been working on, is to give a few examples of some other projects that I've been involved with. So talk about large river problems that Phil touched on earlier. I worked on the Lower Colorado River Multiple Species Conservation Program. So this was a large Endangered Species Act compliance project for river U.S. Bureau of Reclamation river operations on the lower river, you know, Fish and Wildlife Service, three state game and fish agencies, water, power, Indian tribes, ag. You know, it was quite a fun party to attend. And the objective was to, you know, conserve species such as these somewhat bizarre native river fishes in the lower Colorado River, as well as a whole slew of riparian obligates as well. A big constraint to that is stuff like Hoover Dam. And so, you know, we've really completely changed the way the Colorado River functions because of this. And it's not just Hoover Dam. We've put dams all up and down the river. So one of the problems, of course, is there's a whole lot of water and power and flood control being provided out of this system. And so institutionally, this whole big party of people are saying, you know, our objective is to provide water, power, and, you know, flood control protection for everyone. But on the same hand, we want to conserve all these species to depend on these very dynamic systems. The other thing that has occurred because of the change in operations, the impoundment of the river and the change of the hydrology, is you've established these, you know, really pretty high-end sport fishery situations where, and these guys are not a trivial lobby, let me tell you. When we started talking about controlling non-native sport fish, which are piscivorous, they're really largely responsible for, you know, eating the eggs and young of those native river fishes. You know, they just came unglued. And so what you're, you know, the solution for the lower Colorado River ended up being this very intensive, you know, catching the adult fish, artificially spawning them, growing them out in off-channel ponds, and then dumping these young that are big enough to avoid the predators back into the river at the end. Likewise, you know, Phil had said rivers flood, LCR really flooded. So this is showing some of the old floodplain areas. You can see how it's been converted over here, but you know, this is a couple of miles wide. So these were very dynamic system. And a lot of species depend on that dynamic nature of the river to recruit new populations, you know, fields of cottonwood seedlings that come in new alluvium after flooding. But then the river engineers used to describe many reaches as a happy river. It doesn't flood any longer. You know, you've channelized these reaches. This is the straitjacket that Phil was talking about. So the river, the objective was not to let the river leave its banks any longer. You know, you of course could, you know, a little dynamite, a couple of large yellow machines would take care of this problem. Institutionally, that's not going to happen on this system now. When we started talking about reoperating the river to move, you know, it doesn't all look this way. There are reaches that are unarmored. But when you start talking about reoperating the river, which adversely affects some of these other values, you know, Armageddon is about to come down on your head. So what you're stuck with here for riparian species, we're farming willow trees. You know, so the point of this is, you know, in the LCR, it's a very constrained, you know, institutional, financial, all of these constraints are present here. The toolbox is different than if you're in a different river system where reoperation or rethinking flood control projects is an opportunity. So context matters. Okay, consider our public lands, land of many uses indeed. We're extracting stuff. We're trying to conserve special status species and natural resources, active and passive recreation, scenic, visual, cultural resources. You know, some of these land uses are compatible. Some of them are not. You know, so our public land managers spend, you know, a lot of effort doing good science to try to figure out how you make all this work, and you know, lots of good planning to figure out where these different land uses are compatible. I was, when I joined the Conservation Biology Institute, I had the opportunity to work with the Trust for Public Land on their Sierra Checkerboard Initiative. So this is about 1.5 million acre study area in the El Dorado and Tahoe National Forests. Here's Lake Tahoe for reference. The green on this map is all of the national forest land. So the other colors are other land ownership. So if you think it's hard to balance all of those land uses when you own all of the land, imagine if it's all fragmented up like this and your neighbors are doing something that doesn't exactly fit with what your objectives for the land are. So one obvious solution to this is you just buy up all the private land and you give it to the Forest Service and you make it whole. Super expensive. So financially, you know, infeasible. So really the point I want to make here is we have to consider other tools. So, you know, the objective here was, you know, there were some priority areas that TPL was looking to buy to actually transfer to the Forest Service, but think about conservation easements. Think about management agreements. Think about land swaps, which are cheaper and potentially solve the problem or at least get you part of the way there. Okay, non-native species, we've heard about this. Now that I'm at Tejon Ranch Conservancy, we're spending a lot of time thinking about non-native species, and in particular, these guys. So you know the story, super destructive, very prolific, you know, 6 to 8 piglets per litter, 2 to 3 litters a year. You want to talk about geometric growth. Super smart, you know, it's a big, ugly problem. Really widely distributed through California. This is an old map from Fish and Game, 2001. Just to give you a sense of where pigs are, you know, San Diego County is not even shown on there. It is now. They are down in San Diego as of, you know, a few years back. So, you know, public land, private land, you know, you don't have one option that's going to fit all of this. Really expensive, you know, it's all of these constraints for pigs. You know, philosophically, there are some in the hunting community who don't want to get rid of pigs. It is one of the most popular game species in the state. Institutionally, Fish and Game manages them as a big game species. It's about the only state that I know of in the country that doesn't treat them as a pest and manage them appropriately. And there are citizens of the state who don't think we ought to be killing stuff like this. So what is, you know, the solution? I'm actually wondering if biocontrol may be our next option on Tejon Ranch. Okay, so what do we do about some of these constraints? I would argue we really need to look at the big picture. So, you know, a few hundred acres in the middle of an urban matrix is not the same as a big wildland area that still functions naturally. We need to understand what we can achieve in a particular landscape and what the associated constraints in that landscape are. We need to be explicit about, you know, what are our targets, the threats to those targets, and the conditions that we want to get out of for those targets. Is it feasible? You know, we need to ask those questions for different settings. This is, I think, really important for me and my experience. Resources, conservation resources, are always limiting. You know, we spend resources in one area, they are not available to spend in another area. You need to be making wise choices of, you know, are you, for that couple of hundred acres in the urban matrix, are you going to push it so hard to try to restore, you know, whatever? Or do you accept it for an urban park and deal with it in that case? I mean, we've had, you know, local conservation organizations, you know, they've got one gnatcatcher in the middle of, you know, a patch in the middle of the city, and, you know, it's God's gift to gnatcatcher conservation. Let it go. It's not going to make it. I'm sorry. You know, stakeholder agreement, unless you have the ability to control your landscape and make the decisions on your own, you are going to have to get agreement among the stakeholders on what the outcome should be for that and the particular strategies. And then, you know, we just need to continue to learn and evaluate whether our management is working. You know, a lot of people talk about adaptive management, and, you know, it really is the principle that we should be using, and we need to try to do a better job of making it happen. Okay, so I'm going to shift gears. This is my transition to Tejon Ranch. This is a painting by Frank Montague Moore of some of the wildflower displays that he saw on parts of Tejon Ranch back in the 1930s. So first I'll tell you a little bit about the ranch. So Tejon Ranch in the Tehachapi Mountains, it's the largest contiguous private property in the state, 270,000 acres. In 2008, the Tejon Ranch Company, the landowner, a publicly traded company, came to an agreement, a conservation land use agreement, with five environmental groups that resulted in 90% of the property being set aside for conservation. So 240,000 acres, established the Tejon Ranch Conservancy, who I work for, to be the steward of the land and to set the stewardship vision for the property. And then the in exchange for that, the environmental groups that signed the agreement agreed not to oppose the ranch's plans to develop the other 10% of the property. The other point I just wanted to make here is, you know, a really diverse place. You know, some people in the room have been there. You know, we're trying to manage a place, you know, it's really unlike many other parts of California. So it's huge, super diverse. To be honest, we don't understand it at all. When I got here and I said, okay, let's go, let's give me the data, and they handed me a vegetation map. It was done in the 1980s by a forester because they wanted to log the place. That's it. I mean, we've been having to develop a certain amount of science foundation to guide our management planning. So agreement signed in 2008, we were established. We had 5 years to basically develop a management strategy for all of the conserved lands on the ranch. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the work that we did. And I'm going to focus on the grassland resources. So again, think about the scale, 108,000 acres of grasslands on this ranch. It's a big place. And so, you know, acre by acre isn't going to get us where we want to be here. The conservation on Tejon Ranch is via conservation easement. And so the landowner, the company, retains a number of land use rights, hunting, and they do a lot of filming. There's a lot of details, but cattle ranching is one of those reserve rights. We get to maybe change how cattle ranching is done, but we don't get to make it go away ever. So we have to, in some cases, cattle grazing is clearly a problem. We have to also think about it as a tool. And so that's part of what we've been up to. And so again, we don't really understand very much, hadn't understand very much about these grasslands. So we developed a partnership with the Range Ecology Lab at UC Berkeley. This work that I'm going to just briefly touch on is ending up going to be the dissertation of Sherry Spiegel. She'll probably finish up this summer. So the work established a series of permanent plots, 50 of them on across the grasslands on the ranch, randomly assigned, measured veg cover, soil chemistry and texture, other variables, slope and aspect, those sorts of things. And the idea is we really wanted to both understand the physical setting of these grasslands and then the botanical characteristics. And then the first thing that became really obvious is, so this is the corner of the Mojave Desert, the Antelope Valley. The grasslands in the Antelope Valley and the grasslands in the southern San Joaquin Valley are very different from each other. So these are annual dominated. There is virtually no native grass left at all in the San Joaquin Valley. Very nice perennial grasslands still over in the desert side. So I'm going to just focus on the San Joaquin. So in some years, it looks like this. And in some places, it looks like this. So just give you a little sense of what the terrain looks like. I'm looking west in this picture. So these are San Emidio Mountains. This is Fraser Mountain, and then off into the transverse ranges. Foothills of the Tehachapis. I'm going to come back to this, but these low hills that I'm standing on are actually uplifted tertiary sediments, as opposed to this more recent Holocene era sediments that are laid down here. And then the grasslands extend up into the foothills of the Tehachapis, and then you get into actually like blue oak and some of the other oak woodlands. And so one of the things that we've used as sort of an organizing tool, this is a ecological sites is a concept promoted by the Natural Resources Conservation Service for range management purposes, largely is what it's been used for. An ecological site is it's a unit of landscape that has specific soil and other kind of geophysical qualities to it, characteristics to it, that support distinct vegetation communities. And theoretically, at least, those vegetation communities respond in some coherent way to disturbances management actions. And so if we look, I've simplified this a little bit, and this is still sort of playing out as we study and learn more. You can break the San Joaquin Valley grasslands really into three ecological sites. There's these flat, sandy, low nitrogen sites. These site designations, this is just our little monikers that came out of some of the statistical models, and that's just what's stuck in my head now. But so these site two grasslands are the recent alluvium. Site three grasslands, these are we're not at botany yet, these are the sites. So the foothill sites, these are the foothills of the Tehachapis, more sloping and variable textured soils. And then these site four areas, these are those tertiary aged uplifted alluvial deposits. So they were laid down back when the San Joaquin Valley was still an ocean. So there's this kind of interesting chemistry associated with it, high cations, pH, some loamy sand and sandy clay loams. So if we look at then the plant communities, what we see in these recent alluvial areas, site two, they are native forb dominated. So that picture I just showed you of those wildflowers, that's where you see those, is these site two areas. But in site three, really non-native grass, annual Mediterranean grasses. That is what you don't really see a lot of wildflowers. There are some other resources that I'll talk about in a minute. And then in the site four, these tertiary alluvial areas, a mixture, this kind of mess almost of of both native and non-native forests, but then a lot of non-native annual grasses as well. Again, almost no native grass on the San Joaquin Valley side. So just to show you again where these are, so that picture I took, I was standing on this hill looking back this way. So these older terraces, site 4, the recent alluvium, site 2, and then these foothill grasslands, site 3. And just to give you a sense of sort of what they look like, this was in, I'm just going to show you a couple of years. So in 2010, I've also summarized the sort of the functional group cover grasses and forbs, and what you see is site 2, site 3, site 4. So in these recent alluvial areas, you know, significantly higher cover of native forbs. In site 3, it's just, you know, it's really dominated by annual Mediterranean grasses. These forbs are largely not native. There is a little bit of native forb in there, but not quite as much as you see in site 2. And then in the tertiary sediments, the site 4, it's this mixture of stuff. But these states transition from year to year. So just to use 2011 as an example, there were significant changes in all of the functional group cover, where now it is all dominated by Mediterranean grasses. So, you know, just, you know, novel ecosystems has been brought up a couple times. We think this is one of them. We think this is now an annual, Mediterranean annual grasses, and it is going to be darn hard to get it to go another way. We don't see it ever shifting on its own, you know, without our management and intervention at this point. But we see this going back and forth to some degree. Okay. Other conservation targets that we care about at Tejon Ranch, there are a suite of special status animal species. So burrowing owl, these are listed species, the blunt-nosed leopard lizard and the San Joaquin kit fox. You saw some of those wildflowers. I mean, we want to promote native biodiversity. It's not just about single species management for sure. There are, you know, in some years we get incredible native bulb displays. And then there are a whole variety of different, largely annual, almost endemic special status plants. And so if we think about how these targets are distributed, I should have pointed out I'm also using the same sort of color convention. So site 2, these recent alluvial areas, this is where we find this suite of species. Those foothill areas, site 3, is where we tend to see more of the bulbs. And then we really only see these special status annuals, these endemic plants, largely endemic plants, on those older marine terraces. So this really allows us to start thinking about desired conditions for these. And now I'm just going to focus on these site 2 areas. RDM is residual dry matter. This is all another sort of rangeland metrics that is used. Residual dry matter is the amount of plant biomass left on the ground before the next rainy season starts. So for cattlemen, you know, you don't want to remove all of the RDM. You want to leave a little stubble on the ground to keep it, the dirt from eroding away or whatever. These special status animals in the San Joaquin Valley really like this low stature open condition. I'll say we don't know very much about what this place looked like historically. There's very poor information in that regard. But the thinking is it was really more forb dominated. And so the forbs, you know, they die, they dry up, they sort of blow away over the summer, and there's just not very much biomass on the ground. And these species have evolved to deal with that. Now that we've got annual grasses that have invaded, we get a very different situation. So this is poor habitat quality for all of these animal species. They just won't be there. So, you know, the following year, this grass may be gone, right? And the flowers may come back. But if you keep having repeated situations with a lot of this biomass in the ground, these animals are just going to vanish. They're not going to use the habitat anymore. So this allows us to think about a very simplistic conceptual model of what our desired conditions are. So in sort of the optimal state, you know, it's native forb dominated. with low residual dry matter conditions, and these are our targets, and just simplistically, they do good. It looks like when we start getting a lot of early rain, so in November, if it really starts raining a lot, we get a lot of Mediterranean grass germination. There's also, you know, operational issues with the cattle out there that, for whatever reason, if they start grazing some areas a little less than they have, again, can kind of release these grasses and you get a lot of biomass on the ground. In that situation, end up with high residual dry matter and the targets fare poorly. So our management hypothesis is, you know, can we use cattle grazing to control that situation and push it back to the desired state? And we're thinking, you know, if we can get cattle onto those grasslands earlier in the season, particularly in a, you know, an early rainfall year, or, you know, change this kind of behavior by the ranchers, you know, a lot of times you think, you know, the ranchers were sort of laughing at me because I was saying, you know, I want you to graze the hell out of this stuff. And they're like, you know, no conservationist ever told us we want more cattle grazing. But we do. I mean, we think that the cows can, to some degree, control some of the, you know, the annual grass growth. And then we have to think about where that we would do this. So a map of the northern end of Tone Ranch, these yellow lines are fences. So these create pastures that we can think about moving cattle around and changing the, you know, the intensity or the timing of grazing. And those site two pastures are really these along the edges of the ranch. Most of that site two stuff is now converted into agriculture. We really have a very little bit of this left, and there's just not a lot left. That management regime, we are not suggesting be applied into those foothill grasslands, for example. We don't think that there's a reason to do that right now. It's not going to affect the change that we're interested in, the management change that we're interested in. Okay, so I just want to bring it back to our original constraints and sort of how we're dealing with them. So technically, you know, we're still trying to figure out these ecosystems, not just the grasslands, but the entire place. And in particular, do we have these novel ecosystems that, you know, we should just sort of punt on for now and focus our attention on systems that maybe we understand a little bit better or support a little bit higher resource value? Again, those Mediterranean grass-dominated foothill grasslands still have some good stuff in it, but they don't lend themselves. We don't really have a good management hypothesis for them. Institutionally, our mission, the Conservancy's mission, is to preserve, enhance, and restore native biodiversity and ecosystem values. But we have to do that within a private working lands context under conservation easements that give the landowner a whole series of land use rights. So we have bookends on what we can do out there. So financially, again, I think resources are always limiting. In the long term, the Conservancy's resources will come from transfer fees on the development that the company builds. Basically, a tax on each house that they build will come to us. In the very long term, the models project we will have a lot of money. I'll never see a dime of it, but there will be a lot of money. So, but in the short term, we don't have a lot of money. And so we're relying on, you know, philanthropic support. And so we really have to prioritize what we spend our limited dollars on in the short term. It may be that all we're trying to do is sort of hold the line until we get more resources to, you know, to do something more elaborate and intensive down the road. And then philosophically, we've had a ton of debates in our board about what our desired conditions are. We've got a board member who's saying, take it back to 1491 and get every non-native species off the ranch. Then we've got, you know, representatives from the company that are saying, gosh, we've had this, you know, couple hundred year ranching and hunting culture out here. Those are reserved rights, and you need to work within that framework. So, you know, this is what we're dealing with at Tejon Ranch, and I guess to close, our namesake, El Tejon, is the badger. Thank you.